You guys have been asking for it, and now you're going to get it. Today we are diving into transmissions, and we're starting off with the 4-speed, aka the 4L60E or the 4L80E. So stick around. Hey everybody, welcome back to the garage, and thank you to all the new subscribers. If you find any of this content helpful, make sure you hit that subscribe button. And if you could do me a favor, smash that like button, because that's what gets exposure to these videos, drives more traffic, helps me out. I really appreciate all of you. And a lot of you have been asking for these videos in particular, and I've told you in the past, transmissions are not my strong suit. I do know enough to kind of give you some overview on some of these things. So we are going to dive in today into the venerable 700R4, aka the electronically controlled 700R4, which is the 4L60E, and a lot of this will carry over into the 4L80. So this is the 4-speed automatic transmission video. We're going to jump in, look at some of the base settings in there, some things that you can do to kind of adjust shift pressures and shift times, and we'll touch on a couple of the other tables. Just a general know-how approach towards these transmissions. But that being said, as with all tuning, we can make changes that can potentially do damage. So I'm going to throw the disclaimer up there, and then we're going to jump right into a tune looking at a 4L60E. Stick around. This video is intended for educational purposes only. Improper tuning can cause catastrophic mechanical damage, and you should do your own research before attempting any changes like this to a vehicle. Attempt custom tuning at your own risk. Okay, I've got a 2005 GTO automatic tune file opened up here where we're looking at the 4-speed on this. We're just going to start kind of underneath the trans tab and look at the general stuff. There's not a whole lot going on here that we need to mess with on this particular tab. Maybe the command gear control limits. If you're having issues holding gears on dyno pulls, things like that, you might have to adjust these, specifically the max RPM and the max speed, to make sure that you can hold fourth gear. Well, in this case, it would be third gear, because third is going to be your 1-to-1 ratio all the way through to a dyno pull to keep that thing from kicking out and shifting. If your transmission has tap up, tap down on it, which is the paddle shifts or the gear shift select, the manual select, a lot of times those settings, if set right, will allow you to hold gears. We'll look at that in a second also. So in particular, if we jump over into the manual, this is where CAGS is at. We're not comparing, you know, if you're on a manual transmission, this is about the only tab you're going to see. Obviously, we don't have anything underneath the manual section that we care about in this case. On our shift general. So the big ones on this one are our shift pattern types. So there are multiple shift patterns on our vehicles. Generally, drive is considered normal, and then sport or tow haul would be considered like pattern A, and then there can be a pattern B that might be a different mode, such as shifting without traction control on. It's all dependent on the platform, and so we're not going to get too far into that, but know that there is a PID that you can log through this scanner to tell you which shift pattern that you're on. It's a good idea to make sure that you log that whenever you get into transmission tuning, to make sure that the changes that you're making are to the correct table. That being said, I said this is where we select whether or not we have tap up, tap down enabled, whether or not we have our gear ratios properly dialed in. So if you are, and honestly, this isn't anything that we're really ever going to mess with on this. What we're looking is whenever we get into things like shift scheduling, this is going to be a lot of stuff based off of shift speeds. And when I say speeds, I'm talking about the vehicle speed. So if you go in and do the wheel and tire calculator, this stuff is automatically going to be adjusted to change the shift speeds based on your wheel and gear ratio calculations. That also being said though, you can come in here and adjust some of these. As I said, you've got both RPMs and speed that are going to command the shifts on your transmission. And basically, it's kind of one of those situations where the first goal that's achieved, whether it's speed or RPM, is going to be the one that commands the shift. So if you're doing anything that would require you to adjust these shift limits, raising your rev limiter, your gear ratio, stuff like that, you need to adjust both the speed side of it and the RPM side of it to make them match up. So that's why we have a full throttle shift speed, and then we have a full throttle shift RPM, which on this platform, the 1 to 2 goes to 6,400 RPMs, 2 to 3, 6,200, 3 to 4, 5,900. Those are still pretty straightforward. Not a lot of things that we would necessarily adjust on those outside of doing gear swaps. But tap up, tap down, these are the speeds that it will hold. You can see that this table is already maxed out to hold which gear it is all the way up through the throttle position, max speed. RPMs a lot of times will still cause you to shift whenever you are in manual. So there's probably not a whole lot you can do about that other than you might be able to go in and max out your full throttle shift RPMs to go above red line, but you're just gonna bounce it off the rev limiter at that point in time. But something to think about. Shift pressures are the big ones. So here's where we get into where we have the different patterns that we've kind of talked about. If we go into general here, normal shift is gonna use pattern X. Well, in case this actual platform is using pattern X for everything, but this is where you can come in, and on trucks, you'll see the tow haul shift patterns on there, and on cars that maybe have a sport mode, which was used a lot on the 6L80s, on the Corvettes and stuff like that, where you could go into a sport shift and it would automatically firm it up. You can do kind of the same thing. You just need to go in and log to see which pattern that you're in, and then you can change your actual shift pattern. Where it comes into play is whenever we go over onto the patterns themselves and look at what it is doing. And so this is our shift pressure, and basically increasing these values is what kind of firms up our shifting. And that's something that you probably want to play with, but don't get too overboard. You know, you can come in here and bump your 1 to 2 up by 10%. Try that out. And then if my laptop will catch up here, try that out. Same ordeal on the 2 to 3. And as you can see, we're pretty high already on the 3 to 4, and there is no 4 to 5 on this one. So we ignore that, but you can do that on pattern X. And if you are utilizing a pattern Y, you can make those changes. Same ordeal to test those out. Pressure modifiers. This is basically a additional modifier. This is not a direct relation to the pressure of the shift. This is kind of like a multiplier. And that's why it says on here that it increases and decreases by adding positive or negative pressure on top of the existing pressure set point based on things like your power, which is down on your left side, or the oil or the transmission oil temperatures. So you can actually come in here and dial back a little bit of shift pressure as you make more power, or dial up a little more. Once again, you just kind of have to play with your application to see what works for you. Downshift is less important on this as far as adjusting these pressures. You know, we're more concerned about the upshift, getting that real crisp, clean upshift pressure. And then the adaptives are, okay, and somebody correct me by all means if I'm wrong, because there's a lot of misinformation going on about the adaptives out there. A lot of people tell you to disable the adaptives, and you can do that. There's nothing wrong with doing that, other than what the adaptives will actually do is you go out and set a targeted pressure in which you want to do an upshift on it, much like you would on a fuel map where you want to have this much fuel delivered. The adaptives will go out there, and once it kind of gets in that range, it will make adjustments to the shift pressure to bring everything in line. And so you might eventually have firm shifts up at the beginning of it, and as the adaptives come in, they become a little bit soft, or vice versa. And the reason behind that is that original pressure point that you put in there, it's not being hit right away. It has to have some drive time. You have to go out. You have to basically do a reset on those adaptive set points so the transmission can learn. So it works a lot like the long-term fuel trims. You go out, you zero those out, and you have to relearn those fuel trims to get that dialed in perfectly. The adaptives do the same thing. We go out, we set new pressures in, we reset the adaptive set points to let the adaptives then learn and actually hit the targeted pressures. So if you do your pressure changes and it feels good right off the bat, but you have the adaptives on and the pressure dials back and it's not as firm afterwards, that doesn't mean necessarily go in and disable the adaptives. That means go in, bump your pressures up, and then clear the adaptives, do the reset, and let them learn back out to meet and actually reach the appropriate pressure on that. So once again, this is kind of a personal approach towards this. There's a lot of information that goes in different directions. I've never really found anything that has been 100% true as far as that goes. I can tell you on my truck, I have the adaptive still on the 4L6 or the 6L80, and this thing probably needs to have the pressures dialed back because it shifts a little bit too crisp. It's a little bit too abrupt. So that being said, you know, a lot of information out there will say that the adaptives will kill your pressures and cause you to lose that nice, crisp, clean, quick shift. That's not true. After that, we've got shift timing, and the thing about shift timing, once again, we've got the three patterns. You only have to work on the pattern that you're working on in this specific situation is pattern X. You can lower these down, but you're only going to get so fast because the transmission can only shift so fast. So I would only go maybe 10 or 20% faster on this and then see how that goes. If you go in here and try to go any quicker than that, specifically on the lower shifts, it can cause issues. Now on the 3-4 shift in here, it's already set to zero and basically it's just going to shift as fast as the pressure can make it shift, but it's not as critical on that because we're going to talk about that here in a second. But do not go in and just zero this table out. Bring it down maybe 10, 20%, see how that works. And you will get to a point where you are no longer getting results on it and you don't want to go beyond that point because it can cause issues with shifting. Cause some weird shift situations. Pretty straightforward there. The torque converter, the stock stuff normally is all right on this. You might need to adjust it if you have a torque that's looser as far as for the lockup speeds, but you can see on here, like in second gear, it doesn't apply your clutch at all, but in third, it starts to, based on your throttle position, starts to lock up at certain speeds. So 120, if you're drag racing this thing, you might want to max out this table so you don't lock up in third and keep that thing loose. Or if you are on the dyno and you want to make that big number, you might want to set third to be locked up right off the bat and lock all the way through. And it can be a little bit hard on things, so just keep that in mind. So under torque management, we're looking at the big things that we have here is the TCC limit, and this will reduce torque for the converter. That's not the big one. The big one is going to be the torque reduction. This is the amount of torque by percentage that it is going to pull out based off of how much torque you're making in between the different shifts. So you can go out there and adjust a lot of things on the pressures and things like that, and it doesn't feel like it's shifting that well or shifting that hard. And that's because you are pulling a lot of timing out during shifts because of this table. This one is pretty aggressive right here where it's not really pulling timing out until you have torque up in the 300 foot-pounds of range. But that being said, you know, you could come in here, multiply this thing by 90%, and you're taking effectively 10% of your torque management out. But once again, this is just during shifts. If you look at abuse mode, this is your torque reduction. If abuse mode is enabled, this shouldn't be anything that would necessarily affect you because this is more of if you go into limp mode. Stall torque management, you know, it's not even enabled on this one. I'm not sure what diff score necessarily does. It's a lot of options on here. And it's basically a torque reduction action to help protect the differential. But I'm trying to think of an application where I've seen it enabled. So, I mean, we pretty much covered everything on the transmissions. So, as you can see, for the 4L series, the four-speed automatic transmissions, there's not a lot to do in here. You can adjust shift pressures, you can adjust the shift speed, but shift pressure is going to be more, have a bigger impact on how it actually shifts versus the shift speed. Theoretically, if you have a higher pressure, it should shift faster. So work with the pressures and, you know, focus more on those than the speed to get everything dialed in. Once again, on the adapt side of it, there's an option underneath the scanner where you can go in and do a trans fast adapt reset. The fast learn, you don't necessarily want to do that because that's for after swapping it out, but we want to do the adapt reset anytime we make changes to the transmission tune, and then you have to drive it a while. It has to learn those new things. If you don't want to mess with all that, you can try just disabling the adapts. But honestly, I would keep them enabled personally, and I would try and properly tune to get the shifts, feeling the way that my goal is. Other than that, it's straightforward. There's not a lot going on with the four speeds. They are still kind of old technology with some electronics controlled on it. Whenever we get into the six speeds, the Gen 4 platforms, that's when things start getting a lot more complicated. So once again, if you're on a Gen 3 with a 4L60 or 4L80, consider yourself blessed. You've got an easier job at tuning. But in summation, if you have any questions, make sure and hit up the comments below. I'll try and get back to you and answer them as soon as possible. I'm sure there will be a couple out there. We kind of shotgunned through a lot of this, but there's not much to learn. If you haven't already, make sure and hit that subscribe button. I appreciate all the new subscribers. Thanks for stopping by the garage.